Thank you, guys. I appreciate you have a choice of sessions to attend. So I feel very honored that you've chosen to attend this one this afternoon. If you could lock the doors at the back so that nobody could leave, I'd really appreciate it. This session is rather grandly titled Lessons in Content Marketing. That's not a title I came up with. It's a title our marketing manager came up with. But it presumes two things. It presumes that I know something about content marketing. Okay, we'll see how that works out. It presumes that the fact you're here means that you want to learn something about content marketing. So we'll see how that plays out over the next 25 minutes or so. What I want to do in this session is I want to take you through a piece of work that we did this year for Canon, and I'll talk to you about that in a moment. I'll talk to you about this brilliant piece of work we did, which was hugely successful, which won numerous industry awards. But more than show you what we did, try to understand, is there something in this that we can all learn? Is there a blueprint as to what's going to be a more successful way of us all doing more of this type of work? So it's not just a show and tell, but it's what can I learn from this that shows me how I can try and replicate this work? Whether or not you're an advertising client yourself, or a publisher, or a platform, it doesn't matter. We all want to be more successful in this space. And I'll show you why you think you want to be more successful in this space. I'm going to start with a bit of context. And the context starts with a really, really big number. Here's a really big number. The number is $313 billion is predicted to be spent on content marketing by 2019. Okay? I wrote this presentation about a week ago, and that's the number I had. I was in my hotel room last night reading The Drum, because that's how interesting I am. And The Drum say that it's going to be $412 billion by 2021. So by any measure, something is happening in the market right now that you need to be interested in and that you need to be trying to do more successfully. Because more and more advertising dollars are being spent in this space. We as Reuters work with a company called Nubase. And Nubase have published this great white paper called Marketing Priorities, which is exactly that. And it shows us at the moment that the number one priority for CMOs and marketing directors globally is content marketing. It outstrips everything else they're thinking about. Content marketing is a thing that is keeping people awake at night. So we need to learn more about this. And I was intrigued, you know, so I'm based in London. I work throughout Europe and the Middle East, but I don't know as much about your region here. So I was intrigued to know what's happening here in APAC. You know, is it the same that was what we think we're seeing in Europe? Is it the same that I know my colleagues are seeing in the US? It's more. Marketing priorities, this study shows us that content marketing is growing at a faster pace in APAC than it is in my region in EMEA, than it is in the Americas. You guys are showing a growth in this market of 16% year on year. Now, I find that fascinating. Because I can tell you from my experience, people in London think that that's where the innovation and the creativity is happening. I can tell you from my experience that people in the advertising community in New York think that advertising begins and ends in New York because they're American, right? That's how they're going to think, right? But you guys here, if you're in this room and you work in the content marketing space, give yourselves a huge pat on the back because you are driving phenomenal growth in this space, in this region. And I think that's a really, really interesting thing to call out today. So we've seen a really big number. We know there's more and more money being spent. We know that CMOs are preoccupied about how they do content marketing, how they do it better. We can see phenomenal growth in your region. Why are people doing it? Why are more and more people obsessing about content? How do I create content? How do I distribute content? Why are people doing more and more of this type of work? Why is the industry moving in this direction? For me, the answer is engagement. Engagement is what clients want to receive from their audiences. Engagement is what drives the advertising dollars. Therefore, engagement is what publishers are trying to deliver. It's what the platforms are trying to deliver. You are now more likely, remember this, you are more likely to survive a plane crash than click on an advertising banner. True. Take that away this evening, tell your friends, tell your husbands, tell your wives, you're more likely to survive a plane crash than click on an ad banner. But content marketing is driving engagement. And that's why the market is moving more and more towards this space. We did a piece of work earlier this year at Reuters, which we call Content Connect. So as Reuters, you have to remember, we're a news organization. A huge part of our business is supplying independent journalism for news organizations around the world. So we have to be incredibly careful about how we operate in this content marketing space. So we were really keen to understand, how do our users, how do our audiences react to branded content? And what was encouraging that you'll see here, the middle one here tells you that audiences are probably a lot smarter than we usually give them credit for. Audiences understand the difference between branded content and editorial content. Audiences are now smart enough, they're media savvy enough to understand that we all have business models that have a need for both branded content and editorial content. They're okay with that. But what they want, and we'll come back to this time and time again, is they want relevant content. You'd have heard it over the last couple of days. They want relevancy. They want something that interests them. And if you can get that, if you can deliver that relevant content, you will find that many, many, many of our users, audiences, viewers, however you judge your consumers, will prefer sponsored content than your usual advertising formats. If you can get it to be relevant, if they're interested, there's a preference for this type of content. So we've got a big number. We know CMOs are interested in it. We know money is moving around this region. We're beginning to appreciate the audiences understand how branded content works. So how do we do more of it, and how do we do it more often, and how do we do it more successfully? So this is the slide that you get your camera phone out. This is a slide where you take the picture, you take it back into your office, and you say, I saw this guy from Reuters. He knows loads about content marketing, or he's an absolute clown. Whatever you do, don't copy this guy. This is the slide that you want to take a picture of. I believe that if you want to deliver successful content marketing, you need to follow these five key pillars, okay? You need to have, we talked about relevant content. You need to be delivering that in the right context. You need to find the right tone. Where possible, you want some element of personalization or localization, and you need to think very, very clearly about the formats in which you're going to distribute that content. These are my five key pillars. If you follow these as close as you possibly can, I think you're likely to be more successful in content marketing. There's one thing that isn't on this slide, which I'm really, really, really passionate about, and I talk to my team about all the time. And if I could now, I'd write it right away across the bottom. And that's the word authenticity, okay? I've heard it spoken about this morning already in a content marketing session. If you don't have authenticity, your content is just content, right? If you don't have authenticity, you're not going to drive an emotion. You're not going to provoke a reaction. You're not going to start a conversation. You have to have authenticity. The brands, the product, the service, the client, whatever it might be, has to have an authentic reason to be in that conversation. They have to be known to have an opinion, a position. They have to know they have some credibility in that space. The media partner you might choose to create the content or to distribute that content also has to have some resonance in that space. If you can get those two things right, if you can find that authentic moment, then you've really got content which is going to drive engagement. John Hegarty would always say that the fundamental purpose of advertising is to engage and persuade. That's what we're trying to do, right? Engage and persuade. If you don't have authenticity in your content, if the relationships you build or the partners you choose are not authentic, you will neither engage nor will you persuade. You will just waste your money. So as we go through the Canon example, I want you just to sit there and almost, you can put me through an exam, right? You can judge the work that we delivered against these five key pillars. Does the piece of work that you're about to see have the right tone, the right context? Is it personalized? Is it localized? Did we have the right formats? Why was it successful? Is it authentic? So I'm gonna introduce this piece of work. So this conversation started a long time back. and that's something I've also heard talked about today with content marketing, is that these things, let's be honest, they often take longer to find these opportunities. They often take longer to execute these opportunities. So this conversation for me started way back in September 2016. So the client in this conversation is Canon Europe. And Canon were launching a new camera. The camera is called the Canon 5D Mark IV. This camera retails, it starts at about $3,500. So to buy this camera, you need to be a very, very serious amateur photographer, an aspiring professional photographer. More likely you are already in that industry. More likely you probably are a professional photographer. So they're going to launch this camera. And they approached us. This is a very, very terrible prop. This is a flyer for a colleague of mine who's doing a talk later on today. But if you can see that image there, I don't know if you've seen it on posters outside. This is an image that was taken at a Black Lives Matter protest in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And it was taken by one of our photographers, a guy called Jonathan Backman. And he took this image. On the right-hand side of this frame is a lady called Aisha Evans. And she's on the freeway in this small town in Louisiana. And she's about to be arrested by the riot police for obstruction of the freeway. So Aisha Evans stands there. She's very calm. She's very serene. She's very peaceful. And you get this brilliant image of the riot cops with their batons drawn, their riot shields, very aggressive, very intimidating. This photograph, within minutes, went all the way around the world. It won World Press Photo of the Year. It got huge amounts of plaudits. It became an iconic image of the Black Lives Matter protest. Canon know that their camera took that image. Nobody else knows, okay? So Canon came to me and they said, how can we get more of those Baton Rouge moments? How can I be in more of those moments? How can I get more of those stories? And my challenge to them was, well, those are news moments, right? I mean, I'm good, but I can't predict where world news is going to happen. I can't create those moments for you. So the challenge that they gave my team and myself was to think about how we can inspire people around photography. So Canon aren't stupid. They know that you've all got a perfectly good camera in your pocket. They are one of the camera manufacturers that's probably given up on the idea that we are all got smartphones, but they want to embrace that, right? They want to, the fact that we're all taking images is great news. So they want to inspire people to take more images. They want to trigger a debate. How many times do you hear this from your clients? I want to trigger a debate. I want to start a conversation, yeah? I want to get something controversial moving. And they're interested in this idea of changing perspectives. And they kept referencing that great image that I showed you earlier. So our challenge was to think about how we could deliver content that was going to address these three key objectives here. What's interesting, I think, you know, this is a bit of an aside, is that in my experience, Reuters, and we run a team of people called Reuters Plus. So Reuters Plus is the commercial content team of what we do. So it's very clearly delineated between what we do as editorial content. But I think what I'm finding over the last couple of years, especially in content marketing, is that to do this successfully, you are probably going to need to reach out to a number of different agencies who might be specialists in very particular areas. So for a project of this size and complexity, which was executed across six different countries, we had to work with a number of different external partners. And that's very different to what we used to do, right? As publishers, we used to go into advertising agencies, assuming that the advertising agencies held the budget, we'd pitch for the budget, and it was very much that two-way conversation and transaction. I think now to deliver pieces of work like the one you'll see, you probably are gonna have to work with other partners, other experts, and that's a good thing. Don't worry about that, embrace it. So in this particular campaign, Nelson Bostock are the PR company for Canon's professional division. They had good relationships with these two businesses, Remain Different and Urban Gentry. These guys are experts in experiential events. They will help you understand how you can go into cities around the world, understand local regulation, understand local town planning, understand what permits you need. So my point is, for me to deliver this piece of work, I need to work with people who have got other expertise that they can bring to the party. So these guys were really, really fundamental in us delivering this work. These are our photographers who delivered the work. So we used six photographers. We eventually delivered seven stories. Joe here shot two stories, and I'll explain why in a minute. So let's be clear about what's happening here. These are Reuters photographers. For us, Reuters photographers are journalists in every bit the same way that our text journalists are. We don't distinguish between the two. And I, as the commercial director of the business, have no influence whatsoever, nor should I, over what these guys choose to do. Their day job is to go out and find the world's news and bring you the world's news. So we had to be very, very careful about what we were asking them to do and very careful about what the client's understanding was of what they're going to do. So the client wanted to give us their seven key European markets where they are strongest in selling their cameras and where they want to be stronger. I then went and found photographers that I knew either lived in those countries, a German photographer based in Berlin, or photographers that we knew had a particular passion for a particular area or country or knew something about that region. So I worked with these photographers here. But just to be clear, we go to them and we say, look, here's the new Canon 5D Mark IV camera. Go away, come back to us with a story that you are really, really interested to pursue. Come back to us and tell us what you want to tell. How do you want to tell the world stories with these cameras? I didn't tell them, and nor would I ever tell them, what those stories have to be. And we have to be quite clear about how that balance works. So these are the guys that are going to deliver our content. So we ended up shooting seven stories across 6 months. So I'll go from up here and I'll go clockwise. This is our UK story. You'll see a bit more of these in some further detail in a minute. This is a story we did in the UK. This is a story from Italy. That's a story from Germany. The top right-hand corner is Sweden. In the bottom right-hand corner, I'll show you more about this in a second. This is a story from Paris. This one is Spanish. This one's actually South African, which for those of you any good at geography will understand is not a key market for Canon Europe, but I'd explain how we got a South African story involved. So these photographers go out, they come back, they pitch. This is something I really want to talk about. This is something I find really, really important, and this is how I want to publish my photojournalism using this new camera. So here's a little bit more detail around one particular story. So Joe is a guy that shoots two stories for us in this project. He went into an area of Paris called Saint-Denis. So Saint-Denis is a suburb of Paris in the north of Paris. If you've ever been on the Eurostar back to London, it's kind of as you come out of Gare du Nord. Saint-Denis, it's fair to say, is a fairly challenged area. It has quite high unemployment. It has a quite high crime rate. It doesn't have the greatest reputation. But Joe went in there and he found a community of people that were doing really, really creative work. He found fashion designers, he found other photographers, he found musicians, he found people that had great hope, that people had really, really inspiring stories to tell. So he came back, and that was a story that Joe wanted to tell from Saint-Denis in Paris. So what you're about to see is a short video of Joe doing a piece to camera, talking about his story. So as we start to think about the content we create, every single one of those stories has all of these incredible images. Every single one of those stories has a piece from our photographer talking to camera. So this is Joe's story from Paris.
The story I captured was about Paris and its suburbs. I tried to focus on a couple of different artists who are pushing the boundaries of society. They're all children of immigrants from France's former colonies. Two are rappers, one is a designer, and the other one is building a startup. I wanted to tell this story because I wanted to show that actually these are the people who are amongst the most innovative and most creative people from the suburbs of Paris. What inspired me was the fact that I've been working in West Africa for the past 6 years, mainly in Francophone countries. And I've also noticed that a lot of France's most popular stars are from West African countries. The experience was actually a lot of fun. I like hip hop, I like the music that these guys are making. It should be heard by more people, so that was exciting. Everybody knows each other, they all grew up together, they all help each other out, and they're really a tight community. So one of the images that stands out to me is a picture of Wormsteed and his crew. This image might be perceived as threatening, but in actuality, it's really just a picture of him and his friends hanging out. There's another one of Ichon. He's got these neon lights on him. And I like that one just aesthetically. It's just a pleasing picture. One of the things that surprised me a lot was the fact that being an artist is a lot about your business and a lot about how you market yourself. I tried to get pictures of people when they were doing mundane things to try to show that sometimes that was the stronger image. I hope that people see these images as artists who are making great culture and really innovating in society. It's been more than just a shoot, it's actually been building friendships.
Two things that I want to point out from that film, which I think, again, are very, very interesting when I keep talking about authenticity. There's an image there of a guy called Wormsteed. He's a rapper that features quite heavily in this story, and he's on a staircase, and he's doing this, right, as if he's got a gun to his head, okay? Canon are a pretty conservative brand, right? So we got into some really interesting conversations with the client where initially, their initial reaction is, you cannot use that image. We cannot be associated with that image. And they asked us to pull that image. And this went on for a bit more than a week, maybe closer to 2 weeks. And we have to keep coming back to them and saying, well, you asked us to go and find stories that inspire, trigger debate. You asked us to tell the world stories. That's a great image, right? I don't know what that guy's motivation is. I don't know what he's thinking is, but it's a great image. We really think that if you want us to do what you asked us to do, that image stays, and that image did stay, and that image then went on to be one of the iconic images from this story. So I think it's worth, you know, if you're going to try and do this content marketing piece properly, you want to be authentic, you want to be credible, especially for us, you know, when those things are very, very much in the DNA of our business, you have to have some tricky conversations. So be prepared for those. The other thing which I'm really, really proud of in that that video, and it's the same for every single video, there's no product. You never see the camera. There's no product placement. There's no photographer looking at the back of the camera, playing with the lens. You never see the product. If you're gonna do content marketing well, the content is the hero, not the product, okay? In this example here, the camera is the enabler of that content, right? The camera helped us tell those stories. But the hero is the content. The hero actually is the people, the stories of which we tell. But there's no product placement. And if we were in that space where we just used to, you know, talk about advertising messages, it would all be about, here's a camera, here's what it does, here's why it's better than Nikon. This isn't that moment. You asked us to tell stories. You didn't ask us to put the camera front and center. I think that's quite important to point out. So we create all this brilliant photography. How do we distribute it? We own a property called Reuters Wider Image. Reuters Wider Image is the very best of Reuters photojournalism. So if anybody in the room is really passionate about photography and images, you should go on to Reuters Wider Image anyway. This site gives us much more breadth to be able to publish much more of our photography. It enables the photographers to give a lot more context and narrative to their story. So we published all of these stories across a phased release of 6 months. They weren't all published at the same time. I kind of like the idea that in content marketing, you build momentum. I think you're better off building relationships with audiences. So the sequence is quite important. We publish it to Wider Image first, which is our property. We then release all the content to Canon. These are all published on local Canon sites in local markets. They are then translated. So obviously the German story that you'll see in a minute is published in German. We obviously drive traffic from our properties to their properties. So it's quite important. We talked earlier on about personalization or localization. It's quite important, we believe, that you connect with audiences in local language. So these get published across Canon's own properties. We then do something really cool. We go back to the cities and the locations in which these stories were shot, and we do an urban art exhibition. So we go around these cities, the photographer goes back, the photographer does a walking tour, so he gathered some tourists were there, he gathered other enthusiastic photographers, he gathered just, you know, curious people that were in town. So we do this brilliant urban art exhibition. So remember when I was talking about those two other companies, Remain Different and Urban Gentry, they really help us understand what local regulation is in these markets. I talk all the time about authenticity, this image here. So if you remember from Joe's film, he shot that brilliant image of those three women who are working in the fashion industry, designing their own clothes. The image was shot on a street corner. We produced a vinyl wrap. We put the vinyl wrap back on exactly the same street corner. This homeless guy, we didn't realize, that's his spot, right? We asked him, would it be possible? We're just trying to take it. And he's like, no, I'm here all the time, right? This is my home. I'm not going to move just because you want to take a nap. That gives it the authenticity that we were looking for, okay? That stays in. That's the sort of thing that shouldn't be photoshopped out. So we did all these incredible things. We had images on the side of buildings, on bridges, you can see on deck chairs. We had one where we had a truck pulls up, and it looks like a guy is unloading big cardboard boxes from the back of the truck. But as he unloads them in the right sequence, you see this beautiful image on the cardboard boxes that he unloads from the back of the truck. So all sorts of interesting, quirky, arresting ways to try and provoke conversation. You see more of these here. This became a very famous image. So this woman works in one of the bars in Berlin. These are like shutters on the front of a garage door. This is the inside of a record store. So we put the image on the back of an inside of a record store in Sweden, underneath staircases. Other ways of taking content and engaging with audiences. What I quite like to do as Reuters is I quite like to pleasantly surprise people. We're 170 years old as a brand. That doesn't sound very cool, right? What we quite like to do is quite pleasantly surprise people as what we can do, and I think we've done that here. We think we calculated that more than 200,000 people saw this content, followed one of our walking tours. So this is just a little bit, I'll scoot through this because I think we might be running short of time. These are the individual stories. So Hannibal in Berlin. Hannibal in Berlin was wanted to tell the story about the incredible Berlin nightlife that you get, and the incredible nightclubs that you have in Berlin are under threat because property developers are moving in. They want to bulldoze the nightclubs and want to turn them into luxury apartments. And he thought that was a really interesting story to tell. This is a story about the white villages in Andalusia. And the problem they have here is that these are incredibly picturesque places, but there's no work there for young people. So young people are just leaving, they're going into the cities. So what's the future of these villages? What's going to be the next generation of people that come through? We have still no idea why this man is dragging a bull up a hill, but it became a really interesting part of our story. So you hear lots about brands talking about storytelling. We've got a story to tell. You hear lots about publishers saying, we are storytellers. The great thing is these photographers are storytellers. That's what they do, right? So it comes back to finding that authentic moment. These guys tell stories. This is in the Abruzzo region of Italy. So they have a similar thing in the sense that there's a population of people moving out. They used to be famous for the wool industry, but a lot of the mills have closed down. So there's very, very high unemployment. They're also affected a lot by natural earthquake. So if I showed you the film of this, it kind of has a sort of Godfather soundtrack, and it's all quite sad. It's all quite worrying. But I love these nuns here. These are very, very cool. This is a story we shot in Sweden. And this is about, it's about the idea that we imagine cities to all be about capitalism, to all be about hard work and making money. And actually, there's some people here in Malmo that are just taking some time off the grid. They're into their organic food. They're into their slow food. It's a really, really nice story about how people live a contrasting lifestyle in a big city. So I said that Joe shot a story in South Africa. So the Netherlands team of Canon wanted a story that had some Dutch resonance, but it didn't have to actually be in Holland. So we went to Cape Town, and Joe found this brilliant story here, which is a bit of a revival of the Afrikaans language. So there are some really, really cool people in Cape Town that are writing brilliant poetry, putting on theater, writing music, and reclaiming their Afrikaans language. So that's what we use for our Dutch story. This one is one of my personal favorites. So Paul won't mind me saying, Paul is a white, middle-aged gentleman who knows nothing about grime music in Hackney, in East London. So Paul had to go into Hackney, into these tower blocks, and try and build a relationship with these guys and girls over 2 weeks. He had to literally understand how many beats per minute there was in grime music and why that's so important. So he built a story around grime. What happened was, I don't think we started out with a particular theme, but we ended up talking about communities that are probably in a state of transition. People that are, you know, Europe at the moment feels like quite a complicated place. There's lots of things going on in news in Europe, and it can feel like we're in a bit of a moment of transition. So we didn't deliberately start out with that theme, but we found this kind of theme of people that are trying to do really, really creative, inspiring things in spite of probably their obvious circumstances. And that's where we ended up with. And then something pretty incredible happens. We have a launch event in London, which displays all of this incredible imagery. I can't tell you how touching it is to see people in a gallery looking at photography and how excited and emotional people get. I thought it was incredible. After this event, because obviously this is in London, I took our photographers across the road. We went to the pub because that's what people in London do. And lots of people followed us and they wanted to talk to our photographers. And our photographers couldn't believe it. There were people trying to buy them drinks. And I was trying to say to our photographers that in this moment, you guys are the rock stars, right? You've created this incredible content. And now there are people that really want to talk about photography. They really want to understand your stories. So this was a huge success for us. It was a great opportunity for us to get the client involved, to get some of our more senior people at our business involved. It was a great opportunity to show off our work. But the special moment for me in the whole campaign is here. We as Reuters publish content which we put on the Reuters Newswire every single day. Other news organizations around the world take our content. We put these stories into the Reuters Newswire. These stories were picked up all over the world. These stories were picked up in California, Boston, London, Egypt, Turkey, China. These stories were published in their entirety by other publishers, other news organizations, other broadcasters took this content. Imagine how you'd feel as a client when all of a sudden what you thought you were getting from Reuters is then magnified and picked up by all of these incredibly renowned publications around the world. That for me, and I would urge you in your content marketing, I would urge you to try and find that magic moment. Find that moment where you get really excited about what you've done. When I saw that, I thought that was the most exciting part of the whole project, was to see how other publications had trusted the content we created and they published it in its entirety. There's loads and loads and loads of examples of this. It's got apparently an estimated ad value of more than $1 million. But that I thought was a really, really special moment in the campaign. That's when I know we've really created something that has resonated. We heard a lot from the panel this morning around how we're measuring content marketing. Is that still something we need to get better at? I think it's still something we need to get better at. For us, there are some obvious metrics. We know we drove more than 3 million impressions to Canon's properties. What we did here, the end stat that said that 40% of people took an action as a result of seeing the stories. We can run a brand tracking survey, so I can track the people that have seen the content versus the people that haven't seen the content. And I can understand, you know, for those people exposed to the content, what have they actually done? So when it comes to 40% of people took an action, that means that they have either clicked on the content, they've either gone to Canon's site, they may have taken an action on Canon's site, they may have said that they shared content with family or friends, they shared it socially, it may be they purchased a piece of Canon camera equipment. All of that in this context counts as an action, but both the client and myself were really impressed that 40% of people that were exposed to the content took some sort of action. Here's how it plays out on social. So here's our friend again. This is Worms T, right? So now he thinks he's a bit of a hero. He actually goes down to the location where we fly posted his image on a wall, and he takes a video of himself, and he started complaining that there were too many photographers around and too many journalists. He now thinks he's a bit of a superstar because he's been in our campaign. So people that were in the campaign shared it, so that's great. Participants shared it. Some of our own photographers and journalists, Lucy Nicholson is one of our best sports photographers. She was really supportive throughout the whole campaign. She was sharing lots of images. As you'd imagine, we have a huge amount of too many Twitter handles across Reuters. So various parts of Reuters news desks or pictures desks shared the content. So it plays out quite nicely on social. People win awards, okay? I was at the awards ceremony last night. I don't have any time for your cynicism about awards. Let's be honest, we all like to win awards, right? Everybody wants something shiny. Look how happy I am, right? Everybody wants to win an award. So this piece of work was shortlisted for a number of awards, both in Europe and the US. We were lucky enough to win a couple of awards. We won something at Digidate in New York. Client came back to us. Client gave us a strong testimonial. I can say that whilst I've been here this week, I got a new brief from Canon on Wednesday about another project they want to do in the early part of next year. For me, one of the acid tests of how successful was your work is, does your client think they want to do it with you again? Client retention needs to be quite important. So I've taken that as a good sign that we did okay. So I'm going to wrap up. Have a think about where we were with those five key pillars. The content has to be relevant. It has to be in the right context. It has to have the right tone. It should have some personalization, localization, and it should be distributed in an interesting format. How did we do against those things? I think we did okay, right? If there's five pillars, I think I kind of give myself a 4 or 4.5 out of 5. But I come back to that authenticity. I think the relationship between the camera manufacturer, the Reuters photographers, that gives it an authenticity that really resonated with this audience here. So thank you. I've referenced a couple of pieces of research in here. One was the marketing priorities from Nubase. I would urge you all to have a look at that. It's a white paper. I can get you access to that. If any of you want to see any more of the content, you're interested in one particular story, or you want to see some of the short films, come and see me afterwards, and I'll make sure you see more of the content. But thank you very much. Good luck.
Jeff, if anyone has any questions, please raise your hand because there will be microphones moving around, and I can see that we actually already have one here.
Hey, Jeff, thank you very much for that. Thank you very much for pointing out something I've been saying for years, which is that if you want great content, go to content creators. I'm not quite sure why people go and ask PR people and marketing people what they think about content and don't talk to filmmakers and novelists and journalists, but there you go. I'm a filmmaker, so I would say that. My two questions are, I have a two-part question. First question is, you had a brave client there because you said, we don't know what the stories are going to be, and we don't even know thematically how they're going to come together. I'd like to know how you manage that conversation, because clients often want to micromanage every aspect, every shot. They want storyboard everything. Yep. The second question is, a huge amount of the success, which came from social and the pickup on the PR newsfeed, is not stuff that you could have promised for up front. Yep. So how did you charge, and how did you make sure that you were kind of rewarded for that in the right way and that the client valued that financially?
Yeah, two very good questions. To the first question, you know, it's fair to say we are lucky in that we have a very good relationship with Canon, because as you'd imagine, we've got more than 600 photographers around the world. Many of those are using Canon equipment. So there is an intrinsic trust that I guess would be harder to build with a client you've met for the first time. So we did get ourselves into some pretty thorny conversations. What was interesting is a lot of those quite thorny conversations came from their PR company, because the PR company thinks that, hang on a second, you've just shot a short film that doesn't feature the camera. And I get lots of really terse emails from a PR company saying, this must happen, this must happen. Well, the PR company slightly misunderstood what we were trying to do. But I think it does help if you do have a longer term relationship, to answer your first question, to get into those client relationships.
Which can be difficult when people are changing every quarter
who
their suppliers,
right?
and vendors are.
Which is not easy. And you know, and I think that may be sometimes why, certainly from I can only speak as a publisher, my experience is that lots of publishers right now are pitching for lots of this type of work. They aren't necessarily winning quite as much, and it's not scaling quite as quickly as they think they want it to. Maybe some of that is in, you know, clients are moving around, agents are moving around. It takes longer to build that trust that we can deliver this piece for you. You are right, not all of the success that we had I could have predicted at the beginning. There's no way I could have predicted that our news agency partners, CNN, New York Times, would have picked this content up. I couldn't have predicted that. Therefore, I couldn't price for it. The part I can price for is I have photographers in market that are shooting these images. We believe they're of this value. I can price that part. I really think that magic moment where all of those other news organizations took the content, the Reuters value of what we do, the quality of what we produce, really, really helps them, those other news organizations, to believe that they can pick up that content and publish it. But you're right, that's kind of it's a magic part. And when I hear my team now talking to other prospective clients, I do try and manage, you know, we can't promise that, right? If it genuinely is of editorial quality, if that was, it might happen. But please don't go out and promise it.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions floating around? Look, in the meantime, I really wanted to ask you, Jeff, that slide you showed about content marketing keeping people up at night, the figure you showed for programmatic was far lower, when arguably programmatic is far more complex and plagued by more serious problems. So why are we still overwhelmed by something as seemingly simple as content marketing?
I don't think it's simple. I think you had a panel this morning, and the panel this morning, I thought, was they were slightly more skeptical, is not the right word, but they felt like that content marketing was still in its infancy, still finding its feet. And I think what we're hearing is clients desperately think they want to do this, but they're not quite sure how to do it. We have clients that approach us that I promise you have either one or two problems. Problem number one is, hey Reuters, we think we want to do some content marketing, but we have no idea how to do it. We don't have the resource. Can you help us create content? That's client number one. Client number two comes to us and say, hey Reuters, good news. We got tons of content. Nobody's looking at it. Can you help us, right? And I generally find that we're still finding our feet in content marketing. But when you get it right, I really think this is driving engagement. It's driving curiosity. It's creating emotion. But I don't think anybody's pretending it's easy.
All right, I can see the clock very quickly counting down, and I know that you're probably all keen for your afternoon tea break. A quick reminder that at 4 o'clock, or probably a little bit later, we will be back on this stage for our penultimate session, Are Brand Cops Destroying the Meritocracy of Great Ideas? With our panel moderated by Landor President for Southeast Asia Pacific and Japan, Nick Foley. We'll have marketing leaders from Spotify and LinkedIn joining Nick on stage. But for now, please join me in thanking Jeff for what was a fantastic session.
Thank you.